Good morning. Thank you so much for joining me this morning. I'm so glad that you're here each day, opening your Bible with me and or seeking to get to know God in a deeper way, seeking to learn from him and to glean wisdom as we look at David and try to understand how we can live life in a fractured world by faith. He was such a great example of that. We've been talking a lot over the last couple of months about all the challenges that we're living in during these times of COVID and racial injustice and police brutality and raging forest fires and so many things that are going on in our world that we just don't have a lot of control over. We're living in really a season of great difficulty and great suffering. And many of our challenges have been, you know, out in the world. But sometimes we experience a kind of pain and suffering that hits closer to home, and it comes in the form of personal opposition. And this is what we're going to see in David's life. As we look at chapter 22 of 1 Samuel, we're going to see that David flees to a cave to hide. He's on the run from Saul. And then we see Saul show up in Nob and take revenge on the priests who helped David. There's a lot in this chapter that I want us to look at through the lens of opposition. So let me ask you just to think for just a minute. What kind of opposition would you say that you are facing in your life right now? Is there somebody or something that is pressing into you, pressing in the form of a word, a thought, or a deed? You know, sometimes we experience this kind of opposition in our marriages when we have tension, we have a difficult relationship. Sometimes we experience it with teenage children who rebel and who resist our leadership in their lives. We experience it with bosses or coworkers when things go sideways and there's back talk and there's squabbling behind our backs. Opposition can come in the form of a relationship that bears really heavily on our experience or our enjoyment in life. And other times it comes in the form of something rather than somebody, something like a lawsuit or a financial burden or a cancer diagnosis or a job loss or just a number of kinds of things that we all deal with at some point in our lives. And opposition comes in these different forms. It's been said that opposition is a fact, and the Christian who is not conscious of being opposed had better watch himself or herself, for he or she is in great danger. The Bible explains, actually, that opposition is a part of living life in a fractured world. It comes to us in three different ways. It comes to us through the world. The Bible tells us that we have three enemies. The world, which is opposition that comes to us from our culture. The devil, which is opposition that comes to us from the spiritual realm. And the flesh, which is opposition that we encounter from just our own sinful desires that war against our faith and our righteous walk with Christ. Now, certainly, we have seen all three of these enemies opposing David as he is truly seeking to follow God's leadership in his life and to fulfill the plans and purposes that God has ordered for him. But it's just filled with opposition. David has, for most of this time that we've been looking at him, has been right where God has planted him, and yet he is just dealing with so much opposition. You know, remember the last time we were together, David was overcome with fear as he was fleeing from Saul, and he started to make what seemed to be some really rash decisions. He ran straight from Saul's territory into the land of the Philistines, and specifically to the hometown of Gath. Here's the map again, so you can see Gath is number 5, and that's where he was recognized, so he chose to act like a madman in order to escape. Now today we're looking at 1 Samuel 22, and we find that now he has fled back towards home to the cave of Adullam, which is number 6 on the map, Adullam. So let me read for you 1 Samuel 22. We're just going to look at two verses today, but listen carefully. David departed from there and escaped to the cave of Adullam. And when his brothers and all his father's house heard it, they went down there to him. And everyone who was in distress, and everyone who was in debt, and everyone who was bitter in soul gathered to him. And he became commander over them, and there were with him about 400 men. Wow. Okay, well, let's talk about this cave. This cave was a very well-known place in Judah. It was 10 miles from Gath and 15 miles from David's hometown of Bethlehem. This was friendly territory for David for the most part. In Psalms 57 and 142, both of these psalms describe David's experiences as he's living in this cave. Now, I want you to listen specifically to Psalm 57, verses 1 through 5, and I want you to listen to hear the aloneness and the helplessness that David is feeling apart from God's protection. He says, "Be merciful to me, O God, be merciful to me, for in you my soul takes refuge. In the shadow of your wings I will take refuge, till the storms of destruction pass. I cry out to God Most High, to God who fulfills his purpose for me. He will send from heaven and save me. He will put to shame him who tramples on me. God will send out his steadfast love and his faithfulness. My soul is in the midst of lions. I lay down amid fiery beasts, the children of man, whose teeth are spears and arrows, whose tongues are sharp swords. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be all over the earth." Do you hear the cry of his heart? He is crying out to God for his life. He's huddled in a cave. He is fearing for his life, knowing that Saul is wanting to kill him. So he is crying out to God for refuge. You know, David knew that through it all, God was fulfilling his purpose in David's life. Did you hear verse 2? He says, "I cry out to God Most High, to God who fulfills his purpose for me." So in the midst of all of this, he is trusting that God is truly fulfilling his purpose in David's life. That's the thing about God. Nothing is ever wasted in God's economy. No, not even the bad stuff in our life. God is able to redeem all things and use them for his plans and purposes. Interestingly, now David's brothers join him and they come to the cave. That meant that they had also deserted Saul's army and they had also come to David as fugitives. It's most likely that Saul's hatred of David has now created a type of persecution for his entire family. But remember, they also knew that David was God's anointed king, that he was the one that God had chosen to lead Israel. They knew that. They understood that from his defeat of Goliath. God was with David, and so his brothers decided that they would align themselves with him. Smart move. But there, did you hear what I was saying? There were others who came to support David, and they were men who were in deep distress or in great debt. They were men who were disillusioned with how Saul was ruling over the kingdom, and they also wanted to come and align themselves with David. Now, this is so interesting because it takes us right back to 1 Samuel chapter 8, verses 11 through 17, where when the people of Israel were crying out for a king like all the other nations, the prophet Samuel warned them very specifically of what life would be like for them if they had a king like all the other nations. It's in verse 11 of chapter 8. Listen to what Samuel said to them at that moment. He said, "These will be the ways of the king who will reign over you. He will take your sons and appoint them to his chariots and to be his horsemen and to run before his chariots. And he will appoint for himself commanders of thousands and commanders of 50 and some to plow his ground and to reap his harvest and to make his implements of war and the equipment of his chariots. He will take your daughters to be perfumers and cooks and bakers. He will take the best of your fields and vineyards and olive orchards and give them to his servants. He will take the tenth of your grain and of your vineyards and give them to his officers and to his servants. He will make your male servants and female servants and the best of your young men and your donkeys and put them to his work. He will take the tenth of your flocks and you shall be his slaves." Samuel warned the people, "It is not going to go well for you if you ask for a king instead of having a theocracy where God is your king. If you want to be a king, have a king like all the other nations," Samuel said, "it's not going to go well for you." And now here we are. 400 men have shown up to align themselves with David because they are disheartened with the way things have been going. They have a leader now who's a tyrant, just like all of their neighboring nations. So 400 men who were burdened and downtrodden and bitter came to join David, and they were the social outcasts. They had nothing left to lose. Nothing could hurt them as in departing from Saul's loyalty into David's loyalty because they had nothing left to lose. They were those who were down and out, and they were all in with David. And eventually, David's army is going to grow to be 3,000 mighty men. So let's break there for today, because I want us to think about this idea of opposition. You know, have you ever experienced opposition actually working for good in your life? Has opposition ever been used to redirect your path, like in a career, where you've come against opposition with a boss or a coworker, and it has been really what's ended up setting you free to find something better? Or have you ever experienced a blessing in your life that has flown out, that has been derived from opposition? You know, I can recall on several occasions where God used strong opposition in my life to put me on a different course, to redirect my path, to close one chapter and to open another chapter. Now, opposition is painful. It's no question about it. It's painful. But it's also very growth-producing in our lives. And David is going through a season of tremendous opposition, but God is using all of it. He's using it to drive David's heart deeper into faith and trust in God Almighty. He is using it in this moment here to wrap some mighty men around David to strengthen him, to build him up and support him. He's even using the mistakes that David's made to teach him some things. And so with whatever opposition you're facing today, whether it be from the world, the devil, or just from your own sinful desires, let's pray together that God will set us free from that pain, but use the suffering that we're going through for His good purposes. Let me pray. Father, we don't like opposition. It's really painful. It really hurts. And it comes to our lives in many different forms, and most often from people who are closest to us. And that's why I think it hurts so much. And I just want to ask, Lord, that you would heal that pain, that you would use it to further your purposes in our life, that you would actually redeem it for our good and for your glory. And I just pray for whatever kind of opposition we're dealing with today, that you would give us wisdom to know how to navigate it and how to respond to it in a way that glorifies Christ. We ask for your help in this, and we ask in Jesus' name, amen. Well, thank you for joining me today. Tomorrow we're going to continue our story in 1 Samuel 22. And we're going to look at what happens next after all these people come to the cave and support David. So I look forward to seeing you then. Have a great day.